All right, well, welcome back, everybody. Did you have a good lunch? So now you have food in the belly, and now it's the privilege of a speaker to have to try to attempt to keep you awake. So that's okay. I have previous training in being a mathematics teacher, which means I knew every person that walked through my doorway hated the subject. We had to start from there. So, and just for future reference, if any of you ever have any influence in making these decisions, 7 a.m. algebra classes should be illegal. So, because learning does not happen. So I literally had to use a Nerf soccer ball, which we wrote on each of the panels, because the soccer ball, you have the different panels on there. So we'd write a number on those panels, 1 through 30 or so, whatever it was. And that was named Bob. And Bob and I would be up front as I'm trying to teach. And if people, young people, began to experience the joys of what they should be doing at 7 a.m., sleeping, Bob would fly over that direction. Hit them in the head, because I'm a quarterback. So it was good fun, but we would use Bob for doing mental math exercises. So sometimes we'd throw him around, and the rule was we'd say like six, and we'd throw Bob to you, and whatever you, when you caught him, wherever your thumb was, that number, you'd have to multiply it by six. And so do mental math. So if you land on 18, like, you know, and your brain drops, you know, whatever. And just trying to keep the students active with that. Close. 108. Very close. So yeah, Bob and I had fun trying to keep students awake. But so I didn't bring Bob, but we'll try something else. Okay. Well, welcome. What's that?
So that was your duck. The duck here.
The duck has another purpose, which we will see very quickly. Okay. All right. Well, welcome back. Thank you for coming back, and I pray that as we continue to go forward, it's going to make even more and more sense, okay? So we're asking some deep questions. We're going to be wrestling with real issues, being honest about pain, because we've all experienced it, okay? And so, I welcome your questions as we go forward, just kind of marching through our story. I am mostly a storyteller. And in fact, oftentimes if people ask me questions, I usually answer with more stories. So if you're into stories, that's how we do that. Okay, but we'll march forward. But I'd like to just pray again, if that's okay. So let's bow our heads and pray. Mighty God and Father, thank you. Thank you for your love for us. It is greater than we can imagine. You were not willing that any should perish, but that all could come to repentance. And because of that, you have literally poured out all of heaven and the gift of Jesus to redeem us back to your heart. But Father, we live in a broken, damaged world with so much pain and trauma. And because of that, we respond in very different ways. So, Father, I pray that as we take some time to dive deep into these subjects here today, I pray that your Spirit will come and speak to us and through us in community here, and help us to understand that there's a grander purpose for these things that happen. And that instead of having our faith destroyed because of trials, that we may actually be strengthened and transformed by your grace. And we come out shining for your glory. So Father, bless us now. Guide and speak, I pray, and I ask in the name and authority of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Security? We fixed the door problem. So okay. All right. So, well, let's start this way. I do this sometimes with children and children's story, and it gets a little more exciting that way. But what is this?
Russian stacking dolls.
Okay, well, you've jumped to that point, yes, but what does this look like?
A duck.
A duck, correct. A duck. Okay, so now we have, what is this?
Smaller duck.
A smaller duck.
Yeah, smaller.
Correct, okay. Now you guys are completely following all these things just fine. And what do you expect this to be?
A smaller
duck still, very true. Another baby duck, Small duck.
Oh, there's another one inside.
A duck, right? Now, of course, with children, we usually take turns and have the little kids say, duck, duck, right? Okay. Like, you're hoping for a goose, right? Okay. Another duck, right? Okay.
He's not.
And another duck. Okay.
You can barely see him.
Very see him. Oh, it'll get worse.
There's even another one inside of you.
And another duck. Okay.
No, it's a different part. Oh, wow. It does.
If you can get another one out of that after that.
And another duck.
Where?
Little ducky.
Oh my God.
You got one.
Oh, yeah, I'm kidding.
It's an egg.
Yeah. And yeah, what is this?
Oh,
it was an egg, correct?
Okay. Here you have a little, little dinky ducky, or actually just a painted piece of wood. Really, they had to work hard on that one. Okay. Now there's lots of ways you can build on this reality, but one of the questions I want us wrestling with here today specifically is the reasons for pain, okay? The reasons for how what does God do with our grief? You know, we went through that card experience where we picked numbers. There's plenty of room, just gotta grab a chair. You know, we identified just within the room this size how much brokenness and pain there was. Was that kind of eye-opening to you?
Yeah.
Yeah.
To see all of it, you know, and this is the church. And so you start to think, well, why doesn't God protect us from all these things, right? You know, if we're doing the right stuff, if we're praying, if we're asking for his protection, why aren't we being shielded from these things? But we're not. In fact, one author literally says, the people in the church often have more trials than those outside. So there's a question, why? So we'll be wrestling with that a little bit here this afternoon. And so this is one way of thinking about it. So, many authors have described it this way, but, you know, if I have a thought, just a little dinky thought, right, comes in my mind, maybe it's something nice and noble, like pick up that piece of trash, right? I grew up in a high school. My winter job on an Air Force base was to be the garbage collector in my high school. Not good for your self-esteem. Okay. Have all your peers, oh, look, there goes the garbage guy, you know, okay? But what happened was, I'd see garbage, the thought entered my mind, bend down, pick it up, right? Or the thought that comes, call your friend, pray with them, say hello, whatever it may be. You have a thought, if you act on that thought, it creates what? An action, right? So just a simple little thought then builds into an action. And the first time you do that action, it's, you know, sometimes it might feel a little bit difficult and unusual for you. But again, that thought comes, another action comes, and make sure I get in the right order here. Okay? And it creates another action. That's building part of your person, right? And it all starts with these thoughts. Just these dinky little thoughts, they can be temporary, just pops. Have any of your had just a thought just flash into your mind? Yeah. And you're like, where did that come from? Or, you know, could be just things that are happening or indigestion, who knows, whatever. And but as you act on them, they begin to build. And so one author has said, you sow a thought, you reap an action, right? And then as you do that action, it reaps another action, right? And as you do more and more actions, eventually, what do you have?
Habit.
You have habits, that's right. Okay, so you sow the thought, reaps an action, you do these actions over and over again, and eventually you create a habit, right? And as those habits continue to grow based on all those thoughts and those actions, you are becoming who you are. And the way you think, the way you respond, and we would call that your Character, right.
But that could also be whether it's a good habit.
Exactly.
Okay.
Exactly. So if I am thinking, oh, if I just, you know, tell this little white lie, or whatever color we want to choose to call it, this little small lie, then it becomes easier, right, to tell the next one. Mm-hmm. And just builds over and over and over again. And as these thoughts become actions, and these actions eventually become habits, and these habits then eventually begin to form who we are, right? Which becomes our character, which ultimately becomes our destiny. Now, we could keep going. You know where this is headed. But I want to share with you just, this is my personal opinion. I haven't seen this done before, but I think it fits. One of the roles of grief and pain is to break it up. The things that you thought you knew, the answers that you thought you had, grief breaks them all. Yeah, now we have to try to pick ourselves up.
Yeah.
Okay, which is exactly what happens, right? In the grieving process, everything that I thought was true, all the answers that I thought I'd figured out, there's the little dude. Okay, thank you. And you're gonna play puzzle? So in the grieving process, we can put them all in here, maybe. Thank you. Everything that you thought you had figured out, your choices, your habits, who you were, now is a mess, right? And we just, what do we do to start rebuilding things? Okay, so now I've made a statement which is controversial. You know, if you belong to Christ, is it true that you are safe from pain?
No.
No. In fact, in some sense, God allows pain for a purpose in our lives, okay? So, in our particular story, as I shared before, I mentioned how we were, from the outside, maybe the perfect Adventist young person couple. But on the inside, we were broken. We didn't have it all together, although it looked nice on the outside. And so the enemy, as the Bible teaches, the enemy is the one who comes in to kill, steal, and to destroy. But if we belong to Christ, the devil no longer has authority over us, right?
No.
Well, that's biblically true.
Well, what about when when Satan was given authority to go and test Job,
yes,
by taking away his kids, his, yes, farm, animals, etc., etc.?
Excellent.
Okay.
Right, but that's exactly the point. Satan had to get permission.
Oh.
Okay.
The thing is, he did not have control over Job. Job had his heart set to God. That's the difference.
Yes.
So that was that's why he didn't have that.
So, yes, so we're going to build on this in a very powerful way as we dive deeper into these things. But do you realize that when you've surrendered your life to Christ, okay, you are no longer a pawn for the devil to play with?
We sure feel like it.
We do, and that's exactly the point we're going to get to. The feelings, those little liars. But okay, we'll come back to that. Okay, all right. So if the devil has no more authority over us to attack us, and yet bad things are still happening, my children still died on a Sabbath afternoon, wow, what's going on? Why did God allow it? Those are huge questions.
I don't know, just thinking a little bit, it sounds like there might be some kind of like wounded engagement in this whole thing.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah, and I'm going to show you a quote later. I'm not sure which of these times. We'll see where God brings it out. That is just phenomenal. The book Desire of Ages. Advertisement. You guys get that one last time? Mm-hmm. Read the book Desire of Ages. Mm-hmm. Okay. Beautiful. Incredible book.
Yeah.
All right. So there it was. Everything looked good on the outside. But the reality was, I was in serious trouble. You see, I had grown up, as I mentioned, Adventist heritage of sorts. And when I got to public high school and so forth and all the different things, I ended up having a girlfriend who absolutely stole and broke my heart. I mean, I was infatuated, fell hard, all those things. I would just made choices I wouldn't necessarily wanted to do. We were in love and whatever, or infatuation at least. And then she went off to the guy's dorm in the Air Force base and destroyed my trust. I was devastated. My world got destroyed. But in that pain, I began to make some decisions different than what they should have been. One of my decisions was, I'm never gonna let somebody hurt me like that again. Right?
Yep.
Fool me once, shame on you. Fool me twice, shame on me, right? We talk about things like that, right? And so I made a choice as a 19-year-old. I wasn't gonna let someone hit my emotions again. And so I began to literally block off, I'll do this later, stay. Make sure not sticking in my hands, okay. I literally blocked off my emotions, and my desire was to basically be like Superman, okay? No highs, no lows. You're not gonna get at me anymore. No one's gonna hurt me like that again. And I began to close off. Well, here is the rotten reality. You can't pick what emotions you shut down.
No, you can't. No.
If I shut the bad ones off, guess what?
I
lose the good ones. It's the same door. And so I, although from the outside, was perfect Adventist young person, feeding my mind, voraciously studying scripture, reading spirit of prophecy, all these things at a young age, locking those in. But the reality was I was blocking off everyone else because I didn't want to be hurt again. And so I was growing in that way. And then I met my soon-to-be wife and we began to date. And we eventually got married very rapidly, as I mentioned the first time, very stupidly, very quickly, whatever, and very dysfunctional. But the reality was, I was still blocking off all those emotions. I had created these habits over and over and over again. And God, by his grace, wanted to save me from that existence. What a tragic existence to not have joy or peace. Yes, you might avoid, you won't get close enough for someone to hurt you, but that also means you don't experience life. And so I'm convinced that when the enemy came in like a flood, as scripture says, with intentions to kill all four of us, a rollover accident, 55 miles an hour, with four airbags, more than sufficient. Wipe us all out. God said, this far only. Caleb and Abigail, they can sleep. They've lost nothing. But Bryan and Penny, I'm going to save them through it. And this is what he did. Remember, I had blocked off all the emotions, right? No highs, no lows. I wasn't hurt in the accident. I had to see everything. There was no way for me to ignore what I saw. My choices, my life of living like salt flats on Utah or whatever, just nothing, no ups or downs, nothing living there either, right? God just ripped me wide open. He allowed it to happen, to break me from my choices, from my walls and my defenses that I had created in all these decisions. You see, temptation at its simplest definition is my attempt to do something without God. Okay? All the different flavors and things we may talk about, ultimately, It's me saying I'll do it my way instead of God's way. Does that make sense? Yes.
Where I have a problem with, and have had for 40 some years, is why would God allow something to happen if he knew that it was going to totally devastate you, possibly even throw you out of the church because of the pain and anguish and devastation that that person was going to go through?
Yeah.
Because there's been times that we left because I couldn't take another happy Sabbath. Right. Excuse me, I don't mean to be rude.
That's okay.
That's how I felt. They all knew what was going on.
Yeah.
But that was all that I was getting. It wasn't like, here, do you need to talk? Do you need a hug? Do you need this or that? I could not stand to look at one more happy face.
Yes. I want to invite you to stay with me.
I am.
Because we're going to get there.
Okay.
But I'm just trying to help others enter into that reality. Because you've experienced it.
Yes, sir.
Okay. And the length that you're describing is a good portion of the length of my life. And so it's not a comparison. Okay.
No.
But you're asking the right questions. And you're wrestling. And in fact, that's, I believe, why he allows these things. And so I'm hoping as we march forward, you're going to see a bigger picture that is truly beautiful.
Okay.
But we're going to have to sit in the uncomfortableness for a while. Okay. And that's the thing about grief. It destroys all the things you thought you knew. Right? All the habits, all of your techniques that you've used to maintain yourself, right? All of your ways of protecting yourself, all of your ways of making sure no one really continues to hurt you, all of your self-reliance. That makes sense?
Mm-hmm.
Grief destroys that. And so in my specific situation, as we went through that, as God, for whatever reasons, kept me from being unconscious or dead, that I had to actually witness and see everything. I was impotent as a father, useless. And it just ripped me to the shreds, like a chasm, okay? There was no way I could ignore it. There was no way I could deny it. There were no mental tools that I had at any point other than just going nuts, okay? Which, that happened too, okay? There's a time for that too, okay? We'll get there. But in that brokenness, God in his mercy and his grace, because remember, what's 1 Corinthians 10:13 say? You remember that one? You guys have that one memorized? Got a Bible anyway? We'll grab it. God is faithful. He will not allow you to be tempted beyond that which you are able, and with the temptation, he will provide a way of escape. Right. Now that may be a long process this side of eternity, but really short on the other side. Okay? Right? Think of that. Is it 1 Corinthians 10:13? Is that the right one? Did we nail it?
Yeah.
You want to read it for us again, louder?
There has no temptation taken you, but such as common to man. God is faithful, who will not suffer you to be tempted above that which ye are able, but will with temptation also make a way to escape that ye may be able to bear it.
That's quite a promise, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
Doesn't always help when you're in the hell, but it is a promise to hang on to, okay? For whatever reasons that we don't understand, God knows. So, like I mentioned, for me, I had to see these things. I had to experience these things. I couldn't shut it off. For months, I experienced whatever they call those things, flashbacks. My eyes had seen more than my mind could process. I would, you know, we use the words PTSD now. I got it. I had it, but we weren't labeled as such back then in 94. And there would be times I'd be driving down the road and I could feel that is something was coming, and I would just pull off to the side as quickly as possible because I was about to lose all control. As my mind began to go back, what I saw that I couldn't process. And so for months and months, we experienced this brokenness. In that process of him destroying and ripping me wide open, then, as these truths we're going to talk about, as we already hinted at this last time, as those truths began to become true, as I began to reframe things that I knew to be true, then he began to fill that chasm with his faithfulness, amen, with his goodness, okay? And then learning to trust him at the depths, whereas before in that salt flat existence of Superman and nothing get in or out or otherwise, nothing could live. But now he's filled me by his grace, that he's faithful at the darkest possible place. And so I trust him. I don't have to have a plan anymore. I don't have to have the blueprint. He's taught my wife and me how to walk blind, because he's held us through one of the most devastating things that could happen. And he's proven himself to be faithful. Now my wife's experience was different. Remember? She, as I mentioned, had been raised in a dysfunctional home, abusive home, all sorts of things that happened to her at a young age, before the age of 6, was being sexually abused by brother and later father and then even other people. And because of that, with each pain that happens, here's a principle you want to write down or remember or something other. With every pain that happens in your life, there's always a choice. Okay? There's a choice. Where's the little midget? Okay? With each pain, whatever that is, whether it's a church member saying, "Man, Bryan, you forgot your tie today again." Yep. Any pain, or as something as devastating as someone betraying and stabbing you in the back, with every single pain that happens in our lives, we have a choice. You can either choose the path of forgiveness or the path of revenge. One leads to peace. The other is very, very expensive. Mm-hmm. And how many times in our response to pain do we learn to control our circumstances, or to find ways to protect ourselves, okay? To self-preserve. So imagine a young girl being, don't imagine too much. But the abuse, what happens? The questions, the anger, the pain. Why is mom letting this happen? Why is dad doing this? Why? All these things. Each choice that happens, if we rely upon ourselves, we begin to build a process of self-protection, which ultimately means we don't have much room to trust God because we're trusting ourselves. And we want to minimize and protect ourselves from any possible future damage, right? Can you guys imagine this?
Yes.
So as my wife, in her situation, she was coming with all of that brokenness and baggage and so forth. By the way, we had no clue at the ability of love, okay, as I already mentioned. With all of our brokenness in different ways, it's a miracle. It is a miracle from God that we're still married. 34 years last week. But it's work. It's war. I mean, it's intentional. But as she grew up, she had learned to rely on herself. She had learned to minimize any risk. She had learned to be an incredible control freak. Have you met any of those? People who are afraid want control. That's one you can stick on your refrigerator. Bring it to your board meeting. People who are afraid want control. If there's somebody grasping for control, what are they afraid of? Okay? And so grief, brokenness, is one way by which God breaks through those things to bring us to a place where maybe we would choose to trust him instead. So instead of me relying on my abilities or me relying on my techniques or my lies or my habits, all those things that we use to manage people and manage ourselves, instead of trusting those, as he breaks us, he teaches us to trust him. And that begins a new little ducky. Yes?
Okay, I'm sorry, I've got one more question.
That's okay.
Okay, we all say the very first thing in church that God is love, that that's his whole character. But then when you look at, you said the words ripping you wide open, okay, and I've said those same words as well. How is that love?
So I had an infected boil that was so encrusted that it was going to destroy my life. I was going septic.
Okay.
So God did what he needed to do as a great healer. And he ripped me wide open so he could clean me out.
Looking long term, wasn't
he? Very long term.
Yeah.
Because, again, as I mentioned, he's more concerned about our character, our life, our love, than our comfort. Especially this side of heaven. Okay? God's goal, I see your hand. God's goal is to make us more human, fully human. The ability to feel joy and pain, but to be filled with all of him in all of it. The devil's desire is to make us inhuman beasts, where we relinquish our choice and blame everybody for whatever happens to us. The victim world. That's what the devil wants.
Well, that's like the devil wants us dead.
Absolutely.
But if he doesn't want us.
But if he can't outright kill us, he doesn't mind letting us live in hell.
He doesn't mind him making it painful for us.
That's right. Yeah, Jean.
Well, one thing I've learned I'm so grateful for is for God's tough love.
Yeah.
When I fell and injured my shoulder and I couldn't drive anymore, at first I was pretty upset.
Yeah.
But after a few days, I was laying down, which I didn't have much choice about.
Right.
But it occurred to me how much he'd saved me from.
That's right.
And
yeah.
I had the most amazing, honestly sincere worship for him at that moment.
Amen. Yes, we're going to get to that point, God willing. Yes.
Could it be, Bryan, what you're sharing in light of your questions and comments that, you know, our personal crises that we go through is an opportunity for our worldview of things to change.
Exactly.
And we see things probably in a different light that we didn't see it before.
Absolutely. Right. And so as I had mentioned in the first time, remember my picture of God, all these different things, you could even shorten it down. Have you ever heard this one? Do good, get good.
Yes. Yeah.
It's a Christian version of karma, right? Okay. I mean, if I do all the right stuff, then hey, I'm going to have a good life, right? No, because this life is not actually the point. Okay, the devil puts those things in. So there's lies that we've embraced and made them part of who we are, that from the outside, they made everything that we thought made sense, but this is where trials and grief begin to break us and to set us free, so that he can then replace the enemy's lies with his truth. So I'm going to give you a sheet at some point here, not that we're going to read or go through, but it's going to be a resource sheet for you that's describing the biblical truth of what God says about us. Instead of what the world says, or what we've thought, or what people have said about us, or what we've experienced, or whatever it is, God's truth in the face of what we've come to believe in the devil's lies. So you replace the lies with his truth. Thought by thought by thought. Right? Okay, so let me come back into our story here. So I mentioned how Penny, being abused, she had harbored so many things, but yet she still fought to live. And that's what kept her alive. The doctors, they were amazed that she even came through that experience without brain damage. She was not willing to surrender. She kept fighting. And as she did some work later with our counselor, he said it was that fight that has helped her to even overcome the trauma of the abuse and all those things, because she wouldn't surrender completely. Now, I can tell you from a personal relational experience, that has made marriage a lot of fun. Okay, because she's stubborn. And I am too, to be fair. We have different stubbornnesses, and so we have some glorious fireworks. It's wonderful. But in that desire to her not giving up, her tenacity to keep going, God allowed her to experience her injuries. You know, she could have paralyzed hand. She could have just said, oh, poor me. Look what's happened, out of my control. I can't do this, I can't do that. She went to like occupational therapy and they said, well, if you do these things, you might be able to manage. She said, manage? It's not stopping me. And her stubbornness just kicked right in. And so now, most of you, if you were to see my wife, unless you watched her very closely, you wouldn't even know that she's paralyzed in the left hand. You'd have to watch very carefully. She can change diapers faster than I can. She's worked at daycare, so she's had more kids, you know. She's learned to function and cut and do all these kind of things. Now, I have learned that if she's going to hit me, I go to the left side. We're holding hands, I go to the right side. So there's things that you want to work with and stuff. But simple things. She's overcome. It forced her to choose. Okay? That's the key. To choose. You know that wonderful verse in Joshua 24:15, right? Choose you this day whom you'll serve. You see, no matter what happens, you have a choice. Yeah. Hallelujah. Because of what God has done for us in Christ Jesus, we are not victims. We are not orphans. You are not unloved. Okay? You have a heavenly Father. You are cared for. You have been redeemed in Christ Jesus. God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself, right? You have choice. You can choose. But the enemy wants to have people believing they can't. Or that, oh, so-and-so did this, now this is... When we give up our choice, we begin a habit that's going to destroy us. So my wife, she just kept on choosing and fighting, and it forced her to do that. So in his mercy, the same exact accident allows Caleb and Abigail to rest, to sleep, having lost nothing but sin, right? And if you have young children nowadays in the school systems and so forth, you're thinking, hey, yeah, you know, not that we'd ever wish death, but there's worse things than resting and waiting for the return of Jesus. So they've lost nothing. And then God in his majesty and his mercy so orchestrated or overruled events to set me free from the mental problems and break me wide open so he could fill me with his grace to overflowing. And then in Penny's situation, forced her to choose. And in her choosing, she kept fighting and we got help and we began to work through things and began to get the help we needed to go through the process of grief and change. Okay? So for us, We have seen. Now, I know it's not always going to be this way. You know, sister, I don't know how and when God will bring all these things together. I don't know. But I know when we're there in heaven by the grace of God in those 1,000 years, and you're getting the view behind the curtain of all the things, what could have happened, all these different things, and you see how God has worked to the point where we just lift our arms in praise and gratitude and adoration that he has guided and worked in such a way. Won't that be amazing? Yes. Now, so every answer, every question will be answered then. Yes. But it might not always happen here, this time, this side of eternity. Now, in our situation, he has shown us enough of his grace, enough of his faithfulness, and his incredible power to take everything and turn it for good, that for Penny and for me, we look back on that date, December 3, and that's when God saved us. Now, it's kind of a weird thing. It's not like you say thank you. We're not necessarily volunteering to do it again. But he has done so much in our life to save us, our marriage, ourselves individually, to bring back into our world four more beautiful children, to give them life and all those things. I mean, literally, had Caleb and Abigail not died, because my wife has miserable pregnancies. Some of you ladies can relate to that. So after Abigail was born, I volunteered to fix the problem. And then our kids died later that year. So I went back to another doctor, and they tried to rewire. So I'm twice the man I used to be. But there were no guarantees. There was no, I mean, they didn't know. Now, yes, I was in the best of all possible worlds. I was still young and hadn't been too long and so forth, but no guarantees. So literally, had Abigail and Caleb not died and I had that future, we have three children that wouldn't even exist. Okay? I mean, just start thinking about those things. And Elijah, the fact that God coalesced time and space for us to be in the island of Yap at the exact time is when he became number five of this one mother who'd been married to three other men, and the last two just whatever cohabitating, and she had come to the decision in her mind where I can't take care of this child because he's such a it's a shame that I would be in living with my father, my brother's house and fooling around making a baby. And so in their culture, she was completely entitled to kill that baby. Nobody would have argued in Micronesia there in that situation. And so she went, this was Elijah's story, our son. So she went to her neighbor, family member, it's an island, small island, and said, will you take care of my child when he's born? And that family member was an Adventist who said, no, I can't really feed all mine as well as I'd like to, but I know a young couple who might be willing to love that little one. And so this lady, the relative, came to our church after Sabbath one day and asked my wife and me, would you have any interest in adoption? Of course, we did the Adventist answer. We'll pray about it. But inside, it was like, yes! Right? Okay? Some prayers are answered really fast. I don't know if you noticed that. Okay? Now, we wanted to love again. And so, yeah, we waited a half a day. And then we called. And so then the next day, we go traveling to meet this pregnant birth mother. She's sitting there on her bamboo hut there out in the jungle and in the island of Yap. Spinning betel nut through the slats of the bamboo porch there, and assuring us that as soon as she found out she was pregnant, she stopped drinking. And would you take my baby? We didn't know, healthy or otherwise, or who knows. We wanted to love again. And so from that moment on, that was our little boy. My wife took her to all the doctor's offices, the visits, and so forth. And on Thanksgiving Day, we got the phone call at 2 a.m. It's time. So we rattled through the Micronesian roads, picked her up in a pickup truck. Okay. So she was in the front, my wife was in the back, and we rambled all the way through. It was a miracle she wasn't born in the vehicle. And we got to the hospital, and my wife was there in the room witnessing the birth of our little boy. And she had said from the beginning that we could name him. So we chose a name. Name Elijah, because we don't want him to have to worry about death. We want him to stand and to see the return of Jesus and not have to die. He was healthy, beautiful. My wife was there witnessing, holding him, and we took care of him from the very beginning. Isn't God good? Thanksgiving Day. But that's not it. International adoption, not exactly an easy thing, right? Except we were living in Yap. We were serving there in the school. I was the principal. Yap is its own country of Micronesia, but it has American law, uses American money, American postal system, and it's considered kind of part of the Guam area, and so there's lawyers that will do pro bono work on a sliding scale based on your income. But they're in Guam. Their income's a lot more than Yap, okay? Money to coconuts kind of thing. And so they did our international adoption for free.
Praise God.
The only thing we had to pay for was was Elijah's medical bill, which was $30. Social medicine. And the other thing, because he's a Micronesian citizen and all the history and so forth, the United States has an arrangement. Micronesians can travel to the United States without any concerns of visas. They can work, they can have a social security number and so forth. They just don't become American citizens. And so the problem with international adoptions are twofold. One is the adoption itself. The other is getting them in the country, immigration. Both of those were taken care of for $30. And his adoptive paperwork, as I mentioned the first time, was sealed, finished. He was legally ours on December 3, 1997. Wow. Our first two children died on December 3, 1994. Oh, and the night before, December 2, we found out we were pregnant. So less than 8 months later, Hannah was born. God in his majesty and mercy, 3 years to the day, began to give back what the locusts have stolen. All we can do is just say, praise God Almighty. And to think, I mean, when you start going through all those things and the possibilities and so forth, you know, what are the odds? I mean, ridiculous, right? Ridiculous odds. But God is greater. And so, after having our world destroyed, now he's beginning to rebuild us with his love, with his truth, beginning to reframe how we respond to things, okay? And that's where we're going to transition here, is the grieving process, is the process by which we begin to work through and pick all these parts back up, okay? Now, if you read much about grief, you'll find that it's kind of a mystery. We do our best to try to describe it. Some people have written many, Kubler-Ross is one who's written quite a bit about it. And so you have this idea that there's probably gonna be some stages that people go through in grief. Anger, depression, denial, bargaining, okay? Not that these are the only ones, but those seem to be the primary big ones. And they are not linear. Okay, so don't think to yourself, whoo, I was angry for 3 weeks. Okay, now let's get on to the next one. No, it doesn't work like that. Okay? In fact, you'll cycle back and forth through all these things, and the goal as you work through that is to eventually come to the fifth one, acceptance. Okay? You're not all better because you're never going to be the same. But you accept what's happened and you're rebuilding, okay? Now there's another version of this that's a little bit shorter. It's simply called Sarah. And that is when you go through some horrible grief, the first response is shock, okay? Everything you thought you knew is all just destroyed in a moment. So you're just in this horrible time of shock. Then that leads into anger, okay? Because what you thought you had, what you thought was normal, the family that you thought you were blessed with is now devastated, destroyed, or the marriage is gone, the job is dropped, whatever that list of pain and loss is, the anger comes in. And this is one that's interesting. A lot of Christians think that you can't get mad at God. Have you ever wrestled with that thought?
They haven't read Psalms.
You're exactly right, brother. Yeah, they haven't read Psalms, but I was teaching and preaching in Kazakhstan and shared our story. And the people there was like, well, you can't get mad at God. You know what happens when you say you can't get mad at God? Here's the thing, emotions don't go away. That anger doesn't just disappear. It's gonna come out in another way. That's what's tearing a lot of our people up. We have created in the Adventist church We have created a culture of just put on your happy Sabbath face, right? Or you could call it a culture of shame, okay? Where it's about you don't want to express the honest things, and so we just make sure everything looks good. And so we cover it up.
You know, I've heard Doug Batchelor say, fake it till you make it. So there's a little disagreement with what you're saying and what he said there. I'm not starting an argument, I'm just saying that's interesting.
No worries, I gave up arguing years ago.
Yeah, now, right,
there's going to be... There's a place for that, and yeah. Fake may not be the best word, but you make choices. Right. So you choose even though you may not feel.
Right.
Okay, and that's part of what's neat about this process is we learn that our feelings follow the belief and the actions, not the other way around. Whereas most people in the world are being taught that just do what you feel, right? Follow your feelings. And so that may be more of the context. So you have this shock, this anger, and we'll come back to that. And then you have this resistance against what has now changed to become your new normal. And you fight that for quite a while. And then finally, for them, it's step four is the acceptance. So shock, anger, resistance, acceptance. I like to put an H in the end of the word Sarah and say, yeah, hope would be great. Hope or healing. Hope is fantastic, yes. Where you begin to see the other side. But let's go deeper into these things. Okay, so anger, depression, bargaining, denial. Okay, you probably heard those terms before. Okay, why anger? I mean you can be mad at whatever, and you see this when people are frustrated and they kick a dog or they punch a wall, right? Something has not gone the way they want it to go, and in their anger and frustration, they take it out. Well, ultimately, who are we going to blame? I mean, in our situation, we're driving a car on a Sabbath, lose control, tire blew, or who knows what happens, we don't know. Who are we going to blame? I suppose I could blame my wife, but that's not going to go well. Or ourselves, sure.
But if God let it happen, okay, I'm sorry.
No, you're right.
Forgive me for saying it that way.
Yeah.
But that's where I look at. You want to blame Satan because he's the father of all this destroy and brokenness, mm-hmm. et cetera. But God let it happen.
Exactly. So yes, you get angry at God. It's okay. God's big enough to handle our anger. He can handle it.
Mount Blessings, page 71, third paragraph down, talks about that all things happen because of, as if Christ directed it to them. You got it? Yeah, bring that up.
The Father's presence encircled Christ.
Yes, I'll read that.
And nothing failed him except for the blessing of the world.
Yeah.
Here was his source of comfort, and so it is for us.
Right.
Amen. This particular one's from Ministry of Healing, 488, same paragraph. The Father's presence, I'm repeating it for the recording, encircled Christ. And nothing befell him but that which infinite love permitted for the blessing of the world. Okay? Here was his source of comfort. Now, if we stop there, we're going to say to ourselves, yes, of course, right? He's the Savior of the world. He's been sent with a mission. It's understandable that nothing would be able to get through to him without God's permission. Sorry, little one. There you go. Awesome. But the sentence doesn't stop there. There's a comma and says, and it is for us. He, and I'll add he or she who are imbued with the Spirit of Christ abides in Christ. Whatever comes to him or her comes from the Savior who surrounds him with his presence. Nothing can touch them except by the Lord's permission. Isn't that amazing? All our sufferings and sorrows, all our temptations and trials, all our sadness and griefs all our persecutions and privations, in short, all things work together for our good. That's Romans 8:28.
What's the reference?
488, Ministry of Healing. In this last sentence, all experiences and circumstances are God's workmen, whereby good is brought to us. Now, isn't that an amazing statement? Now, it's not easy. Huh?
You almost can't believe it.
Exactly. And the devil doesn't want us to believe it. He wants us to believe we're orphans, that we're victims of whatever, that you are just a random act of all these different things. But no. No. All these things are his workmen whereby he brings good to us. So then that's raising the question, what good is he wanting to bring to us? I've shared part of my story. All of the things, our habits, are things that we get used to doing. The way that we get used to relying upon ourselves, right? He sees the damage that we're causing ourselves. And so if he allows this pain, it's to slow us down, it's to break us up, and it's to give a chance to rebuild us. Yeah.
Something that I hear a lot, personally, is that sometimes things just seem to happen because there's evil in the world, or that there is free will and other people do evil things. And so the struggle being,
see you, little one. Okay.
It's hard for me to imagine a space where God says, "Okay, yeah, go ahead and cause that pain," or there's still free will in other people. We're doing
these. Yeah. Right. This is hinting at the much larger conversation of this theological term called theodicy. Okay. How can God be all powerful and good? And, you know, we don't want to go down that whole rabbit hole, but you're bringing out a very important thing. We live in a world where, because of other people's free choice, bad things happen. It is just part of the reality of these things. However, I believe still that this principle still applies, that God is overruling, directing, protecting, so that we can get to the point as we continue through our journey. What would happen in our lives if we actually began to believe this truth, that nothing enters our life ultimately without God's long-term plan for turning it for good? Now, he's not causing it, okay? It's a bad thing, horrible stuff. God's not saying, oh, let's do that. But he's allowed it so he can turn it for good. Mm-hmm. What would happen in our lives if we actually believed that? Mm-hmm. Yes.
You've been talking, and I keep remembering this song on KLDC. It's called, if it's not good, it's not, he's not done yet.
Oh, amen.
If it's not good, he is not done yet.
Yeah. You know, and we're all looking through the lens dimly, okay? But we're coming back to these deeper questions here. I'm hoping we stay with this process of what grief is. It's breaking down all of our previous ways of thinking. So yes.
No, you just reflect back on Job again, you know. God said to Satan, yeah, go ahead and do what you gotta do. God didn't do it, Satan did it, but God used it, like you said, in to flip it back around in a positive fashion.
That's right.
Well, doesn't the book of James tell us that we're gonna be, I know it's a test, but we have certain trials and temptations, we're to look at them joyfully because it's the proving of our faith and when it all comes down to it. I think that's as simple put as it can be right there.
Those verses are true, but when you're in the middle of the pain, it's hard.
Yeah. I have a problem when, because we're all talking about this as adults.
Yeah. Yeah.
So?
With children?
What good is it for a child to have to go through stuff?
There are going to be lots of questions that we all carry into eternity. And I think that's why God gives us time to sit and to ask. And there are mysteries. I remember I mentioned, for me, initially, faith was my ability to have all the answers. Now, I don't. I don't have the answers. But he's good. I trust him. And for me now, faith is no longer being able to explain God. I can't contain him. But he can fill me. And he can fill each moment with worship and with wonder. And to take each and every day with gratitude and praise, regardless of what's happening. So there's a huge orient that changes. There's a switch in our life as he breaks us to where we move to this point, the Bible verse you referenced. You know, count it all joy when you fall into divers temptations and trials. You know, James 1, like, hello, what are you talking about? Especially in the world we live in today. People would rather complain and moan and groan about insignificant stuff, right?
And the same, we're told to thank God in every situation, not for every situation.
Yes, but to choose to thank. You mentioned Job. This is a part of the introduction to the book of Job from Eugene Peterson. And just three paragraphs. I think you'll find that it fits well with what we're talking about right now. Could be jumping ahead, but it's okay. In our compassion, we don't like to see people suffer, right? And so our instincts are aimed at preventing and alleviating suffering. Have you ever done that? No doubt that is a good impulse. But if we really want to reach out to others who are suffering, we should be careful not to be like Job's friends. Not to do our, quote, helping with the presumption that we can fix things, get rid of them, or make them better. We may look at our suffering friends and imagine how they could have had better marriages, better behaved children, better mental and emotional health. But when we rush in to fix suffering, we need to keep in mind several things. First, no matter how insightful we may be, we don't really understand the full nature of our friends' problems. Second, our friends may not want our advice. Well, there goes Sabbath school class. Okay. All right. Third, the ironic fact of the matter is that more often than not, people do not suffer less when they are committed to following God, but more. When these people go through suffering, their lives are often transformed, deepened, marked with beauty and holiness in remarkable ways that could never have been anticipated before the suffering. So, instead of continuing to focus on preventing suffering, which we simply won't be very successful anyway, perhaps we should begin entering the suffering, participating in so far as we are able, entering the mystery and looking around for God. In other words, we need to quit feeling sorry for people who suffer and instead look up to them, learn from them, and if they will let us, join them in protest and prayer. Pity can be nearsighted and condescending. Shared suffering can be dignifying and life-changing. As we look at Job's suffering and praying and worshiping, we see that he has already blazed a trail of courage and integrity for us to follow. Aren't those amazing words?
What did they mean by protest? Join in protest.
To say, devil, back off. To go to war. And as we go forward in our time together, as we get on the other side of grief, God willing, we're going to talk about the role that we play. You know, the Bible has a special name for us that is incredible. I'll save that. Yes?
I've heard an illustration, it's been a long time, but of a butterfly trying to get out of a cocoon and somebody helping it get out of the cocoon, and the butterfly didn't do well because it didn't exercise the what it needed to get out.
It needed the struggle to move those.
It needed the struggle to get out of that.
Yes.
And I just thought of that was appropriate to what
yes.
you're talking about.
So that brings us back to these aspects of grief, okay? Because remember, this process, pain causes us to pause. And as our life has been devastated, I'm not going to do it again, okay? As our life has been devastated, we have to pick up all the pieces. We begin testing things and going through things in different ways, okay? And finding different answers. So I've talked a little bit about the anger. Okay, let's just deal with that very simply. It's okay to be mad at God. Yell at him. He's big enough to take it. He hasn't given us all the answers. It's okay. You see, feelings are the soul's response to pain. Okay? Just in the same way, if someone comes over and cuts my arm, it hurts. I say, ouch, right? But what happens when someone comes over and is rude to me? For some of us, if we're afraid of ever speaking up, or if we don't want to look like bad Adventists, we just kind of say, we just kind of keep it, right? But yet your soul is saying, ow, that was rude. What are you being so mean for, right? And so you experience something, but yet we begin to close them down. So grief, as you're going to go through the grief, you've got to acknowledge it, okay? One person says it this way, when you deal with pain and suffering, you need to face it, okay? You need to feel it. Be honest with yourself. That anger would come up, or the depression, the times we wake up with absolutely no purpose on earth at all. Why get out of bed? It's dark. It's horrible. I try to describe in my book, but it's tough. And it just keeps going. And there's no end in sight. And there's all you can do is lean into that reality and say, okay, I'm broken. I don't have those answers. The denial? Denial is very difficult. That's when people decide they're not going to accept the reality of what's changed. They're going to just keep going as though it's like before. Or they're not willing to acknowledge what is going to happen. Because, you know, there all kinds of ways this happens. I don't have time to, well, maybe. This time I was in Kazakhstan. I had shared our testimony and so forth for worship services and so forth. And the last night before I was leaving to go back to the States, a lady came up with the translator. And she said, can I talk to you? And so we went to another room. And she said, pretty directly, I don't believe a thing you said. Good start. And she began to attack me verbally through a translator, which is really quite cool. Because her husband had died 2 years before. She didn't believe it. Every day she still saw him in a taxi, in the bus too far to reach, and so she'd constantly be searching for him. Her friends all told her, he's dead. You need to go on. Your four children need a mother. You need to. But she wouldn't believe it. Every single night in denial, she'd just cry herself to sleep, and the kids had to just kind of fend for themselves. Horrendous. And she was broken and angry, and she was locked in that denial. That to have someone say that God is able to turn things, she was just all on mad at me. How dare I say something so insensitive and wrong. And one of the things I've learned is that hurt people, right? And when the body is hurting, guess what the mouth does?
It opens up.
The mouth becomes the machine gun for the arsenal of pain in the gut, right? And even through translation, she just Well, I've learned that when people are hurting and when they're attacking, it does not do any good to argue. In fact, I like to call it the three D's, divine duct tape duty. And add two more, duck and dodge. Okay? So she was just blasting away, and I'm just sitting there ducking and dodging and listening. There's no answers. I can't fix it, right? We just read that. I can't give a wonderful little platitude like we all love to give. It's okay. It's all going to work out. No, it's not. It's horrible. Your husband's dead. Your children have no father. How are you going to survive? It's horrible. And she just blasted away. And I ducked and I dodged and I didn't say anything. For almost 45 minutes, we went through two boxes of Kleenex. She was just crying. Her face was just rigid with the anger and the pain because she'd been locked in this denial and the brokenness for 2 years and not have worked through this at all. And then finally, it stopped. Like the boil was being lanced. And enough had gone out because I hadn't pushed back. I hadn't argued. I hadn't tried to defend God. God can handle it. He's been alive before I was. He'll keep going when I'm gone, right? You don't have to defend God. He's big enough. So I didn't push back. I didn't argue any of those things. And finally, she stopped. And then I was able to share from our experience. Not telling her where hers is wrong, but just this is how God met us in our pain. And we talked about how one of my wife's favorite verses, Psalms 56, verse 8, where God says he keeps a record of our tears in a bottle. He knows your pain. He's not just ignoring us. You're not just an orphan floundering around in this horrible, horrendous world with evil people. No, we're not abandoned. He knows our pain. And my wife would hang on to that verse so many times. Sometimes she'd wake up in the middle of the night in the winter and she'd be like, where's our babies? And she's crying out and what do you say? The tears, just tears and tears. And when she found that verse, it meant so much to her. So I shared that with the lady and I shared how God had begun to bring healing in our lives and we started going forward, but we had to be honest and peace began to come back into her face. It was beautiful. And all this is happening through translation. It took a while. And then, I don't know if I messed up or something, if I said something wrong, who knows? There's lots of triggers. You notice when people are hurting, there's triggers, okay? A way to think of it is this way, very simple way. When your emotions are hurting, all these things are happening, think of it like a sunburn. You are fried, okay? Now guess what? When you are in a sunburn mode, you can't distinguish if it's a happy touch or an angry touch, right? It just hurts, right? So if you're sunburned and you're cooked and your friends come, oh, I'm so glad to see you, whack, right? It hurts. You respond. It's natural. You can't distinguish good or bad. So it's very easy. Hurt people that have been wound up in this, just think, I mean, just imagine this from this point on. When you go to church, just picture every single person with an emotional sunburn and you'll be getting pretty close. Because we've created a culture where we deny it. We're not being real. In fact, we are in danger of having lots of theological correctness, but yet broken, empty, decimated people. Angry, attacking one another. We need healing. So I'm not sure if I managed to touch the wrong spot or what. I don't know what happened, but all of a sudden, that angry face came back and she began to just flip back to the angry against God and the denial. And we'd already worked through things and she'd come to see that God is good. But it was like there was something else. It's almost like there was something else that entered the room. Somebody that doesn't want to see someone set free. And it was amazing. I had been, for a number of months before that, praying and asking God this question: what would it look like to be a child of God now walking this earth? a son of God, a daughter of God? What would it look like if we are actively against the powers of darkness now, right? Like Elder Eichner talked about, right? What would it look like if our hearts were resting in God's care so that we no longer needed the world's approval for our value? Because we know that we're loved, we know that we're accepted, we know that we're significant, we have everything we need now in Christ Jesus. What would happen if we were walking the earth that way, filled with His Spirit? So I've been wrestling and asking that question, reading Desire of Ages and so forth, and the moment that that happened, as we're talking together, and that cloud seemed to come over her eyes, and the angry, and the denial, and the bitterness began to come back, something within me just went to war. I can't really explain it. Never quite had it happen like that since. But a part of me, the Spirit of God, I believe, just began to speak in the name and authority of Jesus against the enemy. And I just went to war against that force that was trying to lock that child back into his grip. And it was incredible. Bible verses kept coming out in the name of Jesus. The translator just kicked it up and was going 90 miles an hour. And for about 45 seconds to a minute or so, just went to war against the enemy and kicked him out. Because he has no authority. In Christ Jesus, the devil has no more authority. Christ has brought the powers out. He's broken that, right? We have nothing to fear from him. What if we actually believe that? And that night, God set her free. And it was an incredible thing. I just remember just in awe coming away afterwards, and we held and all hugged, and to see that stronghold being broken by the power of God, but setting her free from the denial that she had been locked in. See, what people don't realize is if we don't deal with appropriately the anger, the depression, the denial, the bargaining, that one was rough for us too, it was Adventist. Okay, God, I'll get out of bed today as long as you send Jesus real soon. I mean, start making deals. I'll do this, but you better do that. I mean, we try to do our best to control situations even then, don't we? But if we don't work through those things, we will get high-centered on one or two of them. Okay? You may learn to function. You will learn to carry on your life, but you won't be whole. You won't have gone through. And so then we just become shells of people. Empty shells functioning with our triggers, our sunburns, our buttons that people can press, just waiting to blow, instead of becoming a place where we become whole. Where God transforms us in the brokenness and makes us something that we weren't before. And changes what we've come to know to be true. Does this make sense? All right, we have about 10 minutes or so. I have some handouts. We're not going to get to this one here, but we will tomorrow. We're going to talk about addictions. It's going to be fun. We're going to play Jeopardy. Okay? But before you leave, just grab one of these handouts. These are incredible truths about who you are in Christ. Okay? You see, the world, we've grown up in the world that says your value is based upon what you do, what you have, or how you act, right? Okay? Oftentimes, your self-worth is based upon your net worth for some people. Okay? This whole idea of finding our significance, our acceptance, and our security in other things. Those are the lies of the enemy, okay? God's desire is that we come to realize that in Christ, you have all of that now. You don't need people's approval. You have God's acceptance. You don't need financial security. You have the Heavenly Father. You are secure in Him. You don't need to find your significance by what people think of you. You can be free because you are already accepted in the Beloved. I encourage my church members to read the book of Ephesians chapters 1, 2, and 3 every week of your life to remind yourself who you are in Christ. And if you want to really be blessed, pick a translation that you comprehend. Okay? Okay? Find something that speaks to your heart, not just your head, but realize that you've already been chosen in Christ before the foundation of the world to be His, holy and without blame before Him in love. You've been adopted. You've been accepted. According to Ephesians 2, you're literally now reigning with Christ Jesus in the heavenly places. Incredible. So here's a list of verses about how, when you feel rejected, how you can realize you are accepted. About 10 verses. So you can renounce the lie that I'm guilty, unprotected, alone, or abandoned. You know, how many times we protect ourselves and try to do these things and do it our own way. In Christ, I am secure. And then there's verses. I renounce the lie that I'm worthless, inadequate, helpless, or hopeless. In Christ, I am significant. And God says these verses. Incredible ones to keep in your Bible. And then more about the truth about our Heavenly Father. So grab those before you leave. But I want to play for you a song. Not the one that you mentioned, but I want to look for that one. This is a song, and I think in light of what we've talked about here today, may have new meaning for us. And I may play it again before we're done tomorrow, we'll see. But I hope that it'll speak to your heart. Please look at the words. Please let it bless our hearts.
We pray for blessings, we pray for peace, comfort for family, protection while we sleep. We pray for healing, for prosperity. We pray for your mighty hand to ease our suffering. And all the while, you hear each spoken need. Yet love is way too much to give us lesser things. 'Cause what if your blessings come through raindrops? What if your healing comes through tears? What if a thousand sleepless nights are what it takes to know you're near? What if trials of this life are your mercies in disguise? Cry in anger when we cannot feel you near. We doubt your goodness, we doubt your love, as if every promise from your word is not enough. And all the while, you hear each day and long that we'd have faith to believe. 'Cause what if your blessings come through raindrops? What if your healing comes through tears? And what if a thousand sleepless nights? of this in life. The rain, the storms, the hardest nights. All your mercies in disguise.
Road, but the words that are in that song are quite powerful.
Amen.
Is to begin to realize as this process, grieving slows us down, breaks us up, so that by His grace, He can rebuild us. We'll be talking more about that tomorrow, God willing. And His desire for us is way more than you can ever imagine. Higher than the highest human thought are His thoughts that He has for us, right? And He wants us to come to understand that love. Again, Ephesians, He wants us to know the love, to be rooted and grounded, to know the height, the depth, the length, the breadth, to be filled with all the fullness of God, even when bad things happen. To trust that He's working things out in a much larger way. Now, we might not always understand that. And what's that crazy verse that we use all the time from Habakkuk and Romans? The just shall live by what?
Faith alone.
What's that mean? I mean, sometimes, not faking it till you make it, but sometimes it means you trust God even when you don't understand. Another beautiful song I think you guys have sung, I'm not sure. When you can't see His hand, trust His heart. So we're on a journey. I'm grateful to have this chance to walk together with you. We're going to go deeper and more. It's going to be exciting, I believe, because as God transforms us, He then uses us to bless others because of some amazing things that happen in our lives. Father, thank you. Thank you that your ways are not our ways, your thoughts are not our thoughts, your power is beyond our imagination, and your love is deeper than our comprehension. Father, I pray that we will come to know you more, that we will come to trust you. I don't have answers for all the pain that's in this room. You do. I don't know if we'll hear those answers between now and heaven, but I know you're faithful through all of it. And I ask and I pray that we will let you hold us and love us in our pain and take us through that pain. Father, please rescue us from the enemy and all of his plans. Make the reality in our life what the word has already said, that you've transferred us from the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of light through your Son. I pray that you do that, and in many ways do whatever it takes to set us free. So thank you for this time here together. Bless each one of us. Bring us back in your own way tomorrow as we go forward in worship and adoration to your faithfulness and your goodness. And I just say thank you for all that you are doing, and I pray that you'll do even more in setting hearts free. By your grace, I pray in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.